So one morning last week, I hopped into my car to commute here from Santa Barbara and was completely caught off guard to see I only had a few drops of gas left in my tank. Oh, I needed gas urgently. Of course, because I was now in a hurry, the nearest gas station was packed. But as I drove, I saw one space available. Yes. As I began to drive into my spot, another car appeared out of nowhere. It dodged around the car at the second pump and swiftly pulled into my space. Now, according to the rules of order, it was definitely my space. In fact, we almost hit each other. I was speechless and felt the adrenaline fuel my anger. I almost rolled down the window and shouted at her since we nearly collided. But I stopped myself. I know you look shocked. I did stop myself. I drove past, annoyed, and then turned around and waited 3 to 4 minutes for another spot to open. There were openings in the distance, but other cars appeared and pulled into them quickly. Survival of the quickest, it seemed. Well, eventually a space opened up. Of course, the spot was directly on the other side of the pump from the woman who had cut me off, who was still pumping away, filling up her gas guzzler. I was hesitant to take it because I still felt mad and wasn't sure I wanted to risk an awkward situation or even a cold stare. But I was late, so I pulled in and decided just to ignore her. As I was pumping, my eyes wandered, and I noticed two young children in the back seat of her car. I began to wonder about who she was and why she felt the need to be so aggressive. I finished pumping my small hybrid tank, sat back down in my car. And then I noticed a big mark on my windshield that absolutely had to go before I could drive. As I got out of the car and went to get the shared windshield cleaner, the woman approached me and said, "Sorry, are you the woman I cut off?" Surprised, I simply said, "Yes," and began moving away, not wanting to engage any further. And then she said, "I felt really bad, but I'm late taking my two kids to school and I've been waiting for about 10 minutes and the kids were fighting and I just had to get a pump. Sorry I cut you off, I feel awful, but I didn't know what else to do." "Oh," I said, "thanks for explaining, I totally get it now." Wow, I thought, didn't see that one coming. I cleaned the dirt off my windshield and reflected how glad I was that I hadn't expressed my anger out loud. Instead, I wondered what was going on. Okay, if I'm being totally honest, I didn't wonder right away. In fact, I spent most of my energy feeling annoyed. But eventually, with the mesmerizing job of pumping gas to calm me, I noticed her children. Wonder. They were clearly not responsible for their mother's rude move, so I was especially glad I hadn't gotten angry with her. And my wondering led to an explanation that made sense. She too was in a rush, stressed about being late, and just made an impulsive choice, one for which I could finally have some understanding and empathy. As I drove away from the gas station and wove my way towards the 101, I reflected on how often I make assumptions about people. How often I get so wrapped up in my own story and my own needs, I forget to wonder what might be going on for them. It was a perfect lesson in Parker Palmer, the philosopher's mantra, "When the going gets rough, turn to wonder." What worlds of understanding and compassion could open up if we were slower to react and more available to wonder what might be going on for the other person? What could they be struggling with? drove them to that behavior? What story, concerns, and history caused this reaction? It may be curious how engaging wonder more regularly might improve our marriages, our partnerships, our parenting, our communities, and even our day-to-day mundane interactions on the street. Now, wonder is a magical word for me. It has dimensions of awe and mystery. It's a word that opens up possibility. It encourages me to notice the miracles and the beauty all around. Wonder invites reflection upon the mystery of the universe. But wonder also leads us to reflect on our thinking. It can transform our reality or guide us down a new path. What if we were to allow wonder to escort us from reactivity to curiosity, from fear to love, from disease to ease, from confusion to clarity? Our world right now is steeped in fear and reactivity. We seem to be in a perpetual state of crisis and division. Our president tweets at all hours of the night in reaction to the day's events. Our 24/7 news channels are taking any snippet they can and turning it into a heightened, fear-peddling, dramatic story. And many of us are more charged and irritable because of the constant barrage of bigotry, anger, and the horrors of war and terrorism all over the world. The fight for sanity and survival seems to lurk just below the surface for most everyone. The fight for our planet, for healthcare, for human rights and dignity for all, the fight for a living wage, for voting rights and for equal rights, the fight for decency and love, and the greater good of the whole rather than the few, the fight for our Unitarian Universalist values. There's so much at stake. It's the good fight. We fight the good fight, but there is so much to fight for. We as a species are more programmed to react, defend, and fight rather than wonder. It was an important survival technique in the wild, after all. Those who sat and wondered about the nature of existence and intention were eaten. So these instincts of fear, flight, and reactivity are right at the surface, at the core of our DNA. With our current planetary uncertainty, it's only natural that many of us are more easily angered, more edgy, and more reactive. Feels a little like we're constantly under attack, like the air raid sirens are going off many times each day, and we're on alert all the time. It reminds me of my mother's stories growing up in Berlin during World War II. She told me many times of the relentless terror as a young child, as bombs were dropping constantly. You never knew when the next one was coming. In fact, the first 7 years of her life were filled with running and hiding in underground bomb shelters just to survive. How did they make it through these dark days, I wondered? How did they not lose hope, trapped in the grip of fear with a war that many ordinary Germans didn't want? I wondered how one lives with such uncertainty and fear for your life. It made me think of the people in war-torn places today, in Syria, Iraq, Afghanistan, the Sudan, and too many more countries where the threat of death looms persistently and is a daily concern. Imagine you cling to the together and hope and pray these circumstances will soon change. You take care of each other, those around you. You become very grateful for the ordinary things in life and simply for the gift of life for another day. The wonder of being alive takes on a whole new meaning. One of the highlights of this very grim start to my mother's life was when Americans started dropping food from the sky for Berlin during the Russian occupation that followed the end of the war. There were packets of powdered, dehydrated ice cream in these parachuted supplies. The kids went crazy, and my mother said she could make a packet last for hours, dipping her fingers in and licking the delicious sweet powder off them. It was the worst of times, but it's also human nature to remember the best moments too. She never forgot how America brought her such simple hope. Perhaps it was no accident that she married an American and that my brother and I were born in New York, so we would be Americans too. Inspired by that small sweetness and the bitterness of a war-torn childhood. And so I began to wonder, what is most needed during these dark times? In this crisis that may continue for a while in our country and around the world, where do we find the ice cream powder of hope? I think there is hope in wonder. We are living in what Parker Palmer calls the tragic gap. In his book, A Hidden Wholeness, Palmer describes the tragic gap as being between what is and what might be. The gap between where we are now and what could be possible for our world. The tragic gap requires us to hold the tension of opposites as we sit in the place between reality and possibility. An uncomfortable place between what is now and the future we wish could be. In this gap, this in-between place of unknowing, Palmer says we have to reach deep inside ourselves and face what is. We can't will or effort our way out. We have to just be in it. And even though it can be tremendously uncomfortable, we have to sit with it. We have to deal with the suffering, the struggle, and the discomfort of being in this liminal place, this limbo land, this purgatory that is neither the world we knew nor the world we hope to inhabit. And in that place, we have to turn to wonder. To wonder deeply what might shift this reality. How might we get out of this difficult place and move to the other side? How do we transform to something better? Palmer invites us to practice habits that open the heart, that open the mind and invite the soul into being in this difficult place of unknowing. He calls on us to be in the world non-violently by learning to hold the tension of opposites, trusting that the tension itself will pull our hearts and minds open to a third way of thinking and a gap firsthand and wondered what might shift things. I was sicker than I'd been in a long time, and no matter how much I willed myself to recover and did every healing, healthy thing I knew to do, every supplement, herb, and medicine, every carefully chosen food, gallons of water, and even naps, which I rarely take, I didn't feel even a tiny bit better for at least a week or more. A whole family caught this bug and was equally sick, all at the same time. We tried to take care of each other, but we were weak and useless for most of the time. And then I realized I was experiencing Parker Palmer's tragic gap, and it was horribly uncomfortable. All I wanted was to get better. Get to the other side, just turn the corner and be my normal, energetic, healthy self. But I simply couldn't. No amount of willpower, visualization, antibiotics, intention, sleep, soup, or prayer was helping me feel better or stronger. It felt like a dark night of the soul, a walk in an unfamiliar wilderness, in a starless desert with no clear path out. And then I remembered Palmer's invitation to reach deep inside ourselves and face our discomfort. His reminder that we can't will or effort our way out, that we must be in it for as long as it takes. So with no clear end in sight, I turned to wonder. What was this about for me? Where was the learning in this most uncomfortable, difficult place? What was this illness trying to teach me? Where, I wondered, would my energy and health come from again? At first, I couldn't find any answers or clarity. This place of unknowing seemed to go on for a long time. If I was going to be sick, I said to my past herself, I at least wanted to get some learning or growth from it. And then gradually, little by little, insights came to me. It had to do with nourishing myself within and making space to listen deeply. As someone who's normally so extroverted and focused on what's happening around and outside of me, I realized I needed to attend to my soul's inner needs if I wanted my life force to return. So when I eventually emerged from this uncomfortable, tragic gap to the other side, to renewed health and purpose, I actually felt quite transformed. I felt I'd become aware of something I could only have found by being in that tragic gap and turning to wonder. St. Augustine writes, "People go abroad to wonder at the heights of mountains, at the huge waves of the sea, at the long courses of the rivers, at the vast compass of the ocean, at the circular motion of the stars, and they pass by themselves without wondering." They pass by themselves without wondering. At some level, my illness was asking me to pass by myself and wonder what nourished my spirit from within. So I invite us during these precarious times, while we're living in this tragic gap, to wonder what might nourish and sustain our . This particular tragic gap may last a long time. It may fatigue us,
last drop of energy. What do we do need to do then to survive? To stay the course, to feed ourselves so that we can emerge whole at the other side. Will you wonder with me? In a little while, we'll transition to our annual meeting. And I wonder, what if we were to approach it from a place of wonder? What if we were to let curiosity be our guide? How might that questioning liberate us to see a way to move ahead with vision? How might we find our wholeness so we are free to truly transform the world? I believe the future holds unlimited promise and possibility if we turn to wonder. I believe we have a bright, dynamic future ahead of us as a community and as a country. Imagine how we might get there if we simply let wonder guide us. Will you try it with me? Are you open to trying it with me? Are you ready to be wonder-filled? Are you ready to be wonderful? Wonderful.